Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick here in Dallas, Texas area. I'm getting ready to head on down to Louisiana, but before I do, the Lord, I just been hearing from the Lord. Repetitive dream the last several days, and then this morning as I prayed, the Lord give me this text. And it's like this. It's time for the rapture, okay? It is near. The day, no man knows the day or the hour but the Lord only, but we are in the season of the rapture. And so then the Lord just asked me this hypothetical question, and that's how the Lord usually deals with me. So here's the hypothetical question. What do you do when you know that you're going to a wedding? As a matter of fact, if you guys who are following my videos, you will know that I came to the States because I'm supposed to be doing a wedding, going to a wedding here in the States. So, you know, the Lord, that's how the Lord usually deals with people, especially if you're a pastor or in the prophetic. The Lord will use your own life as a parable, you know, and other people's lives as a parable. So here's a parable. Here's a metaphor. I came here to the States to go to a wedding while I'm here. And so it's a metaphor or a parable or showing of like going to the rapture, to go to the wedding, the marriage supper of the Lamb, to his bride, the people that will be raptured, the bride of Christ. So if you know you're going to a wedding in a week, if you knew you were going to a wedding in a week, what would you do? What would you do? That's the question from the Lord. What would you do if you knew you're going to a wedding? Well, of course you would prepare. You would plan and prepare. That's why every time the Lord is talking about the rapture and he's talking about the second coming to the tribulation saints, he's really talking to Israel when he talks about his second coming. When he's talking about the rapture, he's talking to the bride. Second coming, he's talking to Israel and then those tribulation saints, the Gentiles who will be saved during the tribulation. He's saying, he always says, watch. Therefore, if you know not which hour your master will come, watch, look up, be ready, be prepared. Like the 10 virgins, he says that the Lord tells us that when he comes back, it'll be like the 10 virgins that, you know, there's 5 that have oil and 5 that didn't. But the thing that the Lord was showing me just about that parable, look, they went out to meet they already went out to meet the bridegroom. They had already separated themselves. These 10 virgins were together in one place. They weren't in their homes. There wasn't like, you know, the 10 different virgins, they weren't in their parents' house or whatever. No, they had come out and come together as a group for the wedding. They had already separated themselves and come out. And then, once they had separated themselves and called themselves the church, you know, they had come out and joined a church. Here they were as a group, like the wheat and the tare. But then 5 of them had oil and 5 did not. So we can see that even though some people are in the church, that doesn't mean they're in the bride. So there's the Christendom, and then there's Christianity. There's the true church, and then there's, you know, what people see with their eyes, and they call it the church. Okay, so the Lord gave me this other parable. I want to read this to you, and I don't want to change topics, but I just want to hit on this to rightly divide this, okay? Because lots of people who watch the videos and are on YouTube are worshipers of the nation of Israel. Now, God gives them a second chance. If you want to find out about Israel, read Romans 9, 10, and 11, and you will see that they have a second chance. They'll all be saved in one day, and that's a totally different work than the Gentile age that we're in. As Jesus said, the times of the Gentiles will be fulfilled. That's the church age that we're in, the age of grace, the year of Jubilee. You know, this is the acceptable year of the Lord where God is calling in the Gentiles. And this is why. This is one of many parables that the Lord says. Our Lord is speaking to the Sanhedrin. He's speaking to those who will kill him, and they get more angry with this parable. This parable is directed at Israel and what they've done wrong, and also saying, hey, about the Gentile church. Listen to this. This is the Lord speaking. And Jesus, Matthew 22, verse 1. And Jesus answered and spake unto them again by parables, saying, the kingdom of heaven is like unto a certain king, which made a marriage for his son. Okay, that's the Father and then Jesus. And sent forth his servants, that's the prophets, to call them that were bidden to the wedding, and they would not come. That's the prophets from the Old Testament. Again, he sent forth other servants, saying, tell them which are bidden, behold, I have prepared my dinner, my oxen, my fatlings for are killed, and all things are ready. Come into the marriage. When Jesus went in on Palm Sunday, okay, Jesus even cried there and said, oh, Jerusalem, oh, Jerusalem, how I've longed to gather you like a mother hen gathers her chicks, but you would not. And then he said, you know, you will not see me again. Do you say, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord? When he comes back at the end of the tribulation, they rejected the Messiah. As Jesus said, I must first be rejected by this generation. He's talking about Israel. So we must rightly divide the word, but this is not my message. I'm going through this to rightly divide the word and put at naught that there's no gainsaying by those who try to have a different gospel and exalt Israel beyond the fact that they need to be saved. Every person, as Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father except by me. Even Jewish people. He said, John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whomsoever shall believe in him, he didn't give any exemptions, any exceptions, shall not perish but have everlasting life. He said that the wrath of God abides on in that same text. John chapter 3, Jesus said, the wrath of God abides on anyone that's not born again. John 3:3, Jesus spoke to Nicodemus, a leader in the nation of Israel, a leader among their people in the Sanhedrin, and said, except a man be born again, he cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. He was talking to the Jews just as well as anybody else, and specifically he was talking to a Jewish leader at that moment. Don't be confused and disoriented by these people on YouTube who are falsely dividing the word of God. You have to be able to rightly divide the word of God by his Spirit in order to understand the end times. Okay, verse 5, chapter 22 of Matthew, verse 5. Let's see. But they made light of it and went their ways, one to his farm, another to his merchandise. And the remnant took his servants and entreated them spitefully and slew them or killed them. Israel killed the prophets. They even killed, of course, some of the apostles, and they killed James, and they killed the Lord Jesus Christ. But when the king heard thereof, that's God, he was wroth, and he sent forth his armies and destroyed those murderers and burned up their city. Well, what happened in AD 70? Even in before, with Babylonian captivity, the city of Jerusalem was destroyed. Again, it was destroyed in AD 70. And hasn't been complete. You know, it's just now coming back and being restored. Why? Because it's the time for the seven-year tribulation. It's the time of Jacob's trouble, the Bible calls it. The strange work of Yahweh, the day of the Lord, all those names. It's not one day, but the seven-year tribulation period and the thousand-year reign of Christ. That is the day of the Lord for those of you who do not know how to rightly divide the word of God. Let's see. Verse 27. When the king heard of it, okay, he was wroth. Matthew 22, verse 7, he sent forth his armies and burned those, killed, destroyed those murderers and burned up their city. Now this is for us Gentiles. Then saith he unto his servants, the wedding is ready, but they which are bidden were not worthy. They were not worthy. Israel was not worthy. Why? Because they were not covered in the blood of Jesus. The only way to be worthy is through salvation through Christ. Israel is not worthy to enter the kingdom of heaven. Except a man be born again, he cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. Israel cannot enter a kingdom of heaven until they become born again. And the Bible tells us, as I mentioned, Romans chapter 9, 10, 11, we will see that all of Israel will be saved in one day when Jesus Christ returns, as it tells us in Zechariah chapter 12, Zechariah chapter 14, and Zechariah chapter 12, verse 10 specifically, it says they will mourn for the one they pierced, as someone mourns for their firstborn son. And chapter 14, it says, where did you receive these marks in your hands? And he said, I was wounded in the house of my friends. Let's see. Let me read again, Matthew 22, verse 8. Then saith he, that's God the Father, to his servants, the wedding is ready, but they which are bidden are not worthy. Go ye therefore into the highways, and in as many as ye find, bid them to the marriage. That's us, brothers and sisters. That's what's been happening since the day of Pentecost, since the apostles were scattered from persecution and sent out into the world. That's what's been going on to Jerusalem, then to Judea, then to Samaria, then to the othermost parts of the world. The gospel has went forth. Go ye therefore in the highways, as many as ye shall find, bid them to the marriage. So these servants went out into the highways and gathered together as many as they found, both good and bad, and the wedding was furnished with guests. That is the Gentile church. Listen to me. This is the part where these... Now, I've already been dealing with the Judaizers. In this same text, now we're flipping the deal with the so-called greasy gracers, those who believe you can say a prayer one time, follow the devil all your life, and somehow following the devil on that broad road to destruction would lead you to heaven. Now let's see. Now these are a full wedding party. In other words, this is the Christendom. This is the alleged church as man sees it. Verse 11. And when the king came in to see the guest, he saw there a man which has not on a wedding garment. This man was not wearing a wedding garment. And he said unto him, friend, how comest thou in hither not having a wedding garment? And he was speechless. Something else the Lord showed me about this text. For one thing, he was not clothed in the righteousness of Christ. But yet he was in the wedding. He was invited and he came into the wedding, but he wasn't dressed. Number two, he was speechless. The Bible says that we overcome the enemy by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. So when God asked this guy, the king in the parable, asked this man, where's your wedding garments? Says he was speechless. He did not have a testimony. He did not say, oh, because I'm covered in the blood of Jesus. He didn't say anything. He was speechless. He was speechless. He didn't have a testimony. That's why when you go to these churches, as an example, they are not testifying to the blood of Christ. They are testifying to their priesthood, to their victory over the laity, the Nicolaitans, as in Roman Catholicism. They are preaching in these old Protestant denominations. They are preaching environmentalism. They're preaching in the prosperity churches. They're preaching the gospel of money. They're preaching the gospel of miracles only, not promoting the Lord Jesus Christ and miracles in the name of Jesus Christ. Just want to add a disclaimer. Of course, I'm a spirit-filled believer, and I believe in miracles and God blessing us financially and all those things God does do. But they have replaced the gospel of the blood of Jesus and salvation and grace through the Lord Jesus Christ with some other gospel. So they're speechless to the true gospel. They don't have a testimony of the work of Christ in their life. But all of these other things about Mama Mary, and she's their co-redeemer, and then about their idols, these different saints that they testify to how these saints help them instead of the one and true only Lord Jesus Christ, the way, the truth, and the life, as Jesus said. He is the way, truth, and the life. John 14:6. No man comes to the Father except through the Lord Jesus Christ. Let's see. And then after he said to him, friend, comest thou hither not having a wedding garment? And he was speechless. This man did not have a testimony of Jesus Christ. And he was not clothed in the righteousness of Christ. But yet he was in the wedding supper. Same as you're talking about your virgins without oil. Then said the king to the servants, bind him hand and foot and take him away and cast him into outer darkness, where there'll be weeping and gnashing of teeth. For many are called, but few are chosen. And then just to show that it's talking about Israel too, the next verse, of course, he's talking to the Sanhedrin. And then in verse 15, it says, then went the Pharisees and took counsel how they might entangle him in his talk. Okay, so they were wroth. Of course, they were angry at what he was saying. So these people that were part of church, they went to church, they went to mass, they were whatever denomination, any denomination you want to think of, Assemblies of God, Catholic, Baptist, wherever they were. But when it came time for the marriage supper of the Lamb, they were without a testimony and they were naked. Just as the Lord said to the Laodicean church, and that's what we are in, brothers and sisters, the time of the Laodicean lukewarm church, the last church mentioned in Revelation chapter 3, the final church age before the tribulation begins. It says, Jesus says to that church, you think you are rich, but you are not. You are poor, blind, and naked. Just like this man was. He's not dressed for the wedding. He's dressed in robes of prosperity. Maybe maybe he's dressed in some kind of a big pompous, popery outfit, like a Catholic priest and all these different made-up traditional seasons that they come up with, Lent and all this. Maybe he was, a Presbyterian priest and preacher, and they wear some kind of special outfits and all that stuff too, that comes from pagan traditions. So whatever this man was wearing, it was not the garment of righteousness that comes by the blood of Jesus. And whatever he could think of to say, he was speechless, because the only thing you can say to the Lord is, my Lord and my God, Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. Anything other than that, people are speechless in the presence of God, other than to exalt the Lord our God. Brothers and sisters, it is time to prepare for the wedding. And that's what the Lord is talking to me about. I don't care if you are watching this video, which most of you guys are Christians. You don't always have to deal with the non-Christians and the lukewarms and then those who are walking with the Lord, those who want to be baptized in the Holy Spirit to go further in the Lord, all these different people. If you're not a Christian, you need to repent right now that you might have your wedding garment and your testimony. You must cast your spirit and cast yourself at the feet of Jesus and beg, seek his grace and mercy. Call upon the name of the Lord while he may be found. The Bible says that those who call upon the name of the Lord, they shall be saved. Call upon his name. And it also says to repent, therefore, every one of you, and be baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved. And you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Acts chapter 2, verse 38. You must call on the name of the Lord. You must repent of your sins. Turn from your ways. Don't let anybody tell you don't need to repent. What in the world? So in other words, you could just say, hey, Jesus, I believe you died on the cross. I mean, what would be the point of that? That is useless. That's meaningless. Jesus, I believe you did what? I believe that you died for my sins. Oh, so I have sins, so I must confess that I have sins. If I don't repent and say that, hey, I'm a sinner, then what do I need? A Savior. You don't need to be saved if you're not lost. You have to confess that you're lost. You have to confess that you've fallen short of God's glory. The Bible says all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. There's none righteous, no, not one. You know, we need to receive the righteousness of Christ through his blood, through our repentance, through confession that Jesus Christ is Lord. For those of you who are backsliders, you don't want to be one of those five virgins without oil. You need to get back right with God. You need to repent. You need to come back to your first love, as Jesus told those churches, to the first church there, second church, in the book of Revelation chapter 2. Come back to your first love. You've waxed cold. You've fallen away from the Lord. Come back right now, today, immediately. Run back to the Lord Jesus Christ. Those of you who want to do more for the Lord, like I made a video about our travel, and I mentioned this, I'll mention it again. What did Jesus say that God told? What did God tell those people to do? He said, verse 8, Matthew 22, verse 8, then said he to his servants, the wedding is ready, but they which were bidden are not worthy. Go ye therefore into the highways, and as many as you find, bid them to the marriage. So those servants went out into the highways and gathered together as many as they found, both good and bad, and the wedding was finished, furnished with guests. Go out into the highways of the hedges. The Lord has some people in prison right now who are murderers and drug dealers and everything. Some of those are going to get saved and come into the kingdom so we can get out of here and go in the rapture as soon as the time of the Gentiles is fulfilled. There are people in San Francisco in the Castro district who are the most vile, perverted, anonymous sex having with multitudes of people, the worst sodomites in the lowest areas of San Francisco, who are going to become Christians and serve the Lord. As a matter of fact, there's some of my viewers who are homosexuals coming out of that lifestyle and repenting and turning to the Lord, who are my regular viewers and commenters on YouTube, because the Lord called them, and they just need to hear from one of his servants, hey, there's a wedding and the Lord is calling you and bidding you to come. The Lord uses people to go out and spread the gospel. The Lord even sent Peter. An angel told Cornelius in Acts chapter 10 and 11 that, hey, God has a message for you and he's going to send a man to you, Peter, to give you that message. God uses men to give the gospel. Okay. And women. So we need to go out into the highways and hedges. God has poor people, rich people, black people, white people, Hispanic people, whatever, anybody from the world, people that are in dead religion, like who are Buddhists, Hindus, Muslims, Catholics, Presbyterians, people sitting on the back of the pew in Assemblies of God who have been faking and hiding and just being a little terror there, hiding out without their wedding garments. It's not too late for them either. God has a plan. God has a little crowd of people that he's going to call, and they're going to get saved, and then that's it. And they're spread out any level of society. Anywhere in the world that you can think of, there's that little group of people. And then that is where we need to go, into the highways and the hedges, into anywhere, and compel these people to come in. That is our last mission, brothers and sisters, to do that. Now, as I mention in videos all the time, you need to have power. Jesus said in Acts chapter 1, he told the apostles, they had already seen him resurrected. I mean, the gospel was complete. Now, they were just like, for all of you greasy gracers, all you denominational people that don't believe in the power of the Holy Spirit, they had already saw the risen Lord. They were already born again. The apostles were already born again. He had already breathed on them. As a matter of fact, John chapter, at the end of the Gospel of John, the last chapter, he had breathed on them the Holy Spirit. They were already sealed with the Holy Spirit. They were already saved. But Jesus told them, tarry at Jerusalem until you receive power from on high to be a witness, the promised Holy Spirit, to be a witness for me in the uttermost parts of the world. We need to be empowered. We need to receive power from on high to be a witness to the Lord. And then we read at the day of Pentecost, the Holy Spirit came down. They were baptized in the Holy Spirit with evidence of speaking in tongues and prophesying. We see this repeated about five different times in the book of Acts as the great example. Acts chapter 19. Read the first five verses of that when Paul went to Ephesus. This refutes a lot of these different arguments about, oh, it's only for the apostles and all this kind of stuff. We need power today more than they ever needed then. We have medicine that people can be cured. We've got antibiotics. We've got the internet. We've got technology. Almost 100% of people can read and write and all that stuff. people are much more skeptical. There's much more things of this world to entertain people, the internet, television, all those things. They didn't have none of those things in those days. They didn't have good medicine. You couldn't go to the doctor and get cured like people can today. They had nothing to rely on but God. Today, the reason why we don't see miracles is because people are relying on technology and medicine and all of these kind of things instead of relying on the Lord. So that's the kind of things you notice. That's why, you know, people ask these questions. People that are spirit-filled people, they'll follow, you know, television. They'll say, how come it is that we see more miracles in Africa and the Philippines and all these places instead of the United States? I'll tell you why. Because people don't need to use their faith because they're relying on those antibiotics they took. If you were a poor person living in the Philippines or Africa and there's no antibiotics there and there's no money and there's no doctor, and you're going to die if you don't go, you only have a choice but to go to the Lord. But it just goes to show that America, the Laodicean church, thinks they're rich, but they are not. They're poor, blind, and naked. And that's the problem with the United States and the Western world. It become fat and happy off of the, you know, technologies of this world, television, antibiotics, and all that stuff. And they just don't have a need for the Lord. That's what's wrong with what they call postmodernism, especially the Europeans are much more advanced in this than Americans, or they're just too intellectual and too smart for God. The height of arrogance, brothers and sisters, will only be brought low by the power of the Holy Spirit. Signs and wonders is what this world needs more than it has ever needed. If this world has ever needed to see the signs and wonders of the Lord, it is today. Now, the lying signs and wonders is these false prophets, people who are claiming that they're God. And then it's so sad. You're going to answer for this. If you're watching me and you're one of these old, particularly Baptist, particularly number one worst for this, saying that when they see Pentecostal preachers, they say, oh, that's a lying signs and wonders. If someone is doing it in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and giving glory to the Lord Jesus Christ, I'll give you a clue. That is not a false prophet. A false prophet is giving a different gospel, leading people away from the Lord Jesus Christ. Okay, the lying signs and wonders will be done by the Antichrist, the false prophet, and all of these false messiahs that will come in claiming to be the Christ. Not by people who are preachers of the gospel, following the biblical example of using the power of God being used for people to be healed. And that is the problem in the church. You'll give an account for stumbling people with all of your blasphemy of the Holy Spirit. We need the power of God today more than ever. And that's why the Lord sent me to the United States. That's why the Lord put me on YouTube, to say, wake up. I'm just a person just like anybody else. But God uses people to call His chosen people, the people that He's called. We Gentile members of the bride are called faithful and chosen. When you say that, all these Judaizers are just like, oh, the Israelis are God's chosen people. We are adopted children of Abraham through the blood of Christ. We have been brought nigh by the blood of Jesus. We are called, chosen, and faithful. Hey, the Bible says in Hebrews, we have a much better covenant than what they have. We do have a better covenant. We don't have to follow the law. We're covered by the blood of Jesus. We don't have to sacrifice those animals. We don't have to endure the tribulation. Like, it's called the time of Jacob's trouble. It's not about the church. It's about the nation of Israel, number one. And secondarily, by God's grace and mercy, there will be Gentiles who had not heard the gospel and didn't understand it, and people that were called up and by these, false churches and all this. There's related to seeing Nicolaitans who have controlled people and led them to a different gospel. Those people who are honestly and sincerely confused, not spitefully choosing to reject the Lord, those people will believe the lie, the strong delusion. Those who have spitefully rejected the gospel, 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. But those who are sincerely deceived or ignorant in all this, they will have a second chance and become the tribulation saints along with the nation of Israel. But we, brothers and sisters, who are part of the bride, we have that blessed hope. The blessed hope is to meet the Lord in the air. The blessed hope is the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ to His bride to meet us in the air. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 16, 17, and 18. For the Lord Himself, Jesus Christ, shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. And us who are alive and remain shall be caught up with them to meet the Lord in the air. Therefore shall we forever be with the Lord. That wherefore comfort one another with these words. The Lord Jesus Christ, in John chapter 14, He has gone to prepare a place for us. In His Father's house are many mansions. This is before the tribulation period. We will be hidden by the Lord in heaven for 7 years. Praise God, there is no better deal that has ever been made. The opportunity, that is the blessed hope too, to never taste death, to never experience the Lord's judgment on this earth, but to be caught up to meet him in the air. Only for one generation. Brothers and sisters, it appears to me, according to the word of God and the signs of the times, that we could be highly likely are that generation to never see death, to never taste of death on this earth, but to be caught up, that blessed hope of meeting and seeing our Lord and Savior in the air. Therefore, I tell you to comfort one another with these words and prepare against the third day, as the Lord has told me several times, and there's a brother, Gary, the Lord had also spoke to him about that, as I'd given a word too from the Lord about that about a year ago or 2 years ago, to prepare against the third day. Go back and read in Exodus how the children of Israel prepared to meet the Lord at the giving of the Ten Commandments. That is a metaphoric way of what we need to do, what I'm talking about in this video. Preparing for the wedding. Having your wedding garments without spot or wrinkle. Don't believe all these lies that you don't need any oil to go into the wedding. That you need oil to light your path to go into the wedding. Don't believe the lies of the greasy gracers that you can do whatever you want to. Don't believe the lies of the Judaizers that in order to be saved, you have to go through the tribulation. There are people on YouTube saying that, you have to be refined and have your salvation refined by going through the tribulation before you can enter the kingdom of heaven. Well, how fair would that be to all the generations that have lived in the past? So people that are not alive during the tribulation can't enter heaven. Only those who are purified by tribulation, the tribulation, can go to heaven. That totally doesn't make sense. That's totally untrue what the gospel says. Brothers and sisters, prepare against the third day. Read that text from Exodus. Read Matthew chapter 22, 23, 24, 25. Get it in your mind and your heart. A, that you'll be prepared to enter into the wedding supper. And then please, brothers and sisters, let me be honest with you. Stop thinking about yourself and start thinking about getting beyond yourself. Stop clowning around at the altar of sacrifice. I mean, that's why most people can't never have any experience with God. They can't receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. They can't be used by God to win people because they're still at the brazen altar of sacrifice. They're still repenting of their sins. They still keep clowning around living in sin. So they're in the outer court out there at the brazen altar, like in the temple of King Solomon or the tabernacle in the wilderness. They're still clowning around at the brazen altar of repentance instead of heading in to the holy place and then on into the holy of holies. You know, you got to get past that. And then God can use. So stop thinking about yourself and, what am I going to do? And think about, hey, God has a call on my life to go into the highways and hedges. I mean, physician, heal thyself. You can't go into the highways and hedges until you've made yourself right with God. Get right with God. Stop making excuses. Stop clowning around. Because, brothers and sisters, the days are numbered. The time is short. The kingdom of heaven is at hand. Repent, therefore, and put on your wedding garment. For the Lord has his people that are called, faithful, and chosen. God bless you guys. I will see you there. If not on this earth, I will see you there at the marriage supper of the Lamb. And by the grace of God, may you be wearing your wedding garments.